Okay, on the second plan, we were studying the tense formula for the evaluation of the study of in the study of literature. So in other most important respect, tense theory must be produce unsatisfactory, neglect the individual. First he neglect the individual, then the race. In the sample, he considered the individual as a sample of the race. So neglecting the individual, he naturally neglect personality as an originating force. So he notes the manner in which the age affects the author, the manner in which the author affects the age he does not note, but the relation of literature and life is a double-sided relation. While the work of a great author is fed up by the combined influence of his epoch, it enters again into the epoch as one of its most important seminal elements. If we cannot understand Victorian literature unless we connect it with the large social and intellectual movements of Victorian civilization, neither can we understand those movements themselves unless we realize we cannot it with the large social and intellectual movements of Victorian civilization, neither we can understand these movements themselves unless we realize how they are stimulated or guided or checked by contemporary literature. The names of Tennyson and Browning or Carlyle and Ruskin and Dickens, to take the most prominent examples only, are the names of men who counted enormously in the development of the time spirit of the world, carefully to keep the double-sided relationship always in view. So in the study of literature, we need to keep the double-sided relationship. First, relationship with the literature and then with the life. So it is necessary, it is required that while reading with or dealing with these writers, we must need to study literature as literature and life as a double-sided relationship, not as a single one. So it is the development of the time spirit of the world in which they lived. In our own study, therefore, we must be careful to keep the double-sided relationship always in view. So what Hudson suggested that okay, we must carefully keep the double-sided relationship always in view. We must regard the great writers as the creator as well as the creator of his time, and while keep to appreciate what the age gave to him, we must be equally solicitous to discover what is given turn to gave them. So it is evident that the tense attempt to write the literary history of the English people on the basis of a formula in which the fundamental elements of individuality is particularly ignored. So first of all, he is giving us that what are the drawbacks of tense formula of writing in the history of English people, that he ignored the individuality of the writer was necessary for doomed to failure, and then it is the nature of the things, no such scientific treatment of literary fact and problem can be other than any disappointing. At any rate, for the student of literature, it remained for us nonetheless to insist on the great interest and importance of the study of literature as literature on the sociological side. It is sometimes felt that to lack literature in this way is to destroy our personal sense of the life in it, that when we adopt the historical method, great books, instead of being enjoyed as expression of individual thought and feeling and masterpiece of art, come to be regarded rather as a specimen to be analyzed with critical disinterestedness, or classified antiquated like the bones of dead animals in the Museum of Anatomy. One may well be paradoxed with the sympathizing with such a misgiving. At the same time, it should now be appeared it is given by Hudson but we are here to highlight the major point, that what is actually he wants to convey to us that what tense attempt to write? He attempt to write the history of English people, but he failed to maintain the individuality of the author or individuality of the nation. So it happened, or at the same time it must be now be apparent that it is really founded upon a mistaken idea of the historical method and its result to relate literature to the whole world of varied activity of which it wants expression is not to destroy its or living interest, but to make that interest broad and deeper without ceasing to be essentially individual. So we need not to seize the individual qualities of the author. Literature thus come to be more comprehensively man. So literature is a name or is an alternative form to understand and comprehend the man. So moreover, by realizing the relativity of literature, we gain a point of view from which every aspect of literary art becomes quickened for us into fresh significance. Henceforth, we need not find any period of literary history wholly wanted in the first approach to the necessarily seem to us both dull and unattractive matter for the specialist, not for the general student. Thoughts, feelings, ideal changes, the fashion of their bygone generation, and many a book which one held its readers spellbound seems to vapid and futile things to us. Passion and other manners of speech. Our textbook writers and professional critics seldom acknowledge this, and by their failure, what happened to do, they often discourage young and untried students. We are apt to feel that their own inability to take the vital and personal interest in man's book, which figure predominantly in the annals of literature, is entirely due to some radical defect of themselves. This is not necessarily so. Of even the greatest book of the past, there are contemporary few which have not suffered more or less seriously, which while all but the very greatest have suffered much from the change which are very going in life, taste, and in the any idle and unwise to attempt to deny the fact, to shirk its obvious implication. But it is precisely have that the value of what we call the history or sociological study of literature should become apparent. So when we take up the historical point of view, we can carry any book, even the dullest, back into the life out of which they originally grew. We can place ourselves to become to some extent in the relationship of its first reader with it, and the result is that the rich life blood of humanity began to flow once more through its long deep pages. Forms of art which is used for archaic subject and method which can never now be revived suddenly become interest. So he speaks about how to make literature interesting and how to make literature useful and knowledgeable for the student. So this book gives us the different ways, and it gives us the different demerits of studying or using different formulas that individuality is wholly ignored, and it only on the record of what man once found potent to move, charm, concern, inspire, if only as one example of what once seemed beautiful and engage as them. Literature which we might otherwise pass over as hopeless deficient in every element of appeal reveal itself as worthy of close and sympathetic attention. It will live again for us if only by virtue of the life which was once in it. So the book which we use to study or which we need to study is should give us the full we should read the book according to the process or according to the systematical approach that Tennyson has given us to follow. We should not understand that how it will affect a student or reader's mind when it does not maintain the individuality. So the first of all, we need to understand that that the reader should read the according to the element of individuality, and through which we can come across that what the writer's individual value is. So this is up to so far. We will come with the next topic.